Hi, I'm Leia Nightlick. I'm Scott Nightlick's amazing 10-year-old daughter. Now, I know that Scott Nightlick usually talks about toys in his videos, since he made me watch them, but I don't really know much about toys, so today we're going to be talking about gymnastics, because I'm a gymnast. So, Nadia Comaneci was the first gymnast to score a perfect 10.
Leia, I need the microphone back.
Aww,
okay. Thank you.
Fine.
Thank you. Okay. Oh, thank you, sweetie. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Spectra Creative Channel. This is Scott Toy Guru Nightlick, your regular host for these videos. And today we are talking about 2011 retailer exclusives for the DC Universe Classics line. And I kind of bunched all of the exclusives into one video because while we had a bunch of retailer exclusives, a lot of 2-packs, a 5-pack, it just made more sense to do them all together. So, exclusives. They're a balancing act. I mean, they're a major balancing act between producing something good and doing it on budget, shall we say? But they also have to do a lot of other things. And kind of the big secret in the industry is that exclusives aren't really designed for customers, they're designed for retailers. They're designed to draw customers into retail, so it's the job of the toy maker to design an exclusive for a specific retailer that's both going to meet their needs, but will also ideally wind up in the basket. But even if a customer can't find the exclusive, the whole point is they've come into the store and probably bought other things. And I know that's kind of the source of what a lot of frustration about exclusives existing with collectors is. But at the end of the day, they're really part of a bargaining chip for retailers to take the main line. All right. And as I mentioned before, they have to be done, I'm not going to say cheap, not inexpensive, but they're not going to have the biggest distribution. So essentially, they have to be kid-friendly because they're at retail. So they have to be something that's going to appeal to children at the end of the day. But because this is also a collector line, it would be really nice if the exclusives also appealed to the adult collector, like me, like you, probably listening to this video. So you're already trying to balance a lot. And because it's an exclusive and it has limited distribution compared to a mainline item, you're usually not going to get tooling dollars, which means you have to deal with the tools you have and find clever ways of repainting them. All of this adds up to a very narrow path and a narrow bridge to walk because there's a lot of restrictions around creating exclusives. They have to do a lot of things. They basically wear a lot of hats. Appeal to kids, appeal to collectors, work for a specific retailer, draw customers into that retailer, whether or not they can actually find it, and ideally be a repaint of an existing tool or a reissue of an existing tool in a way that customers are going to be interested in buying it. Whew, yeah, it's a lot of work doing exclusives. It's a lot more than doing the main line. But fortunately, driving this ship is a superhero. And that superhero is Bill Beneke, who is really good at doing everything I just laid out. Very clever, and he's an excellent, from a design standpoint, he knows his stuff. Well, okay, maybe not Iron Man, maybe we should use a picture of Batman here because this is a DC line. But you get my point. When you have a designer who's also a collector, and I'll throw myself in there, a marketing manager who's also a collector, it helps a lot versus a regular brand manager who's just, you know, doing stuff. So the two of us put our brains together and we came up with some really cool exclusives for 2011. We're going to kick it off by looking at some Walmart 2-packs. We'll look at some other 2-packs and then we'll finally conclude with 2011's 5-pack. All right, so as I said, we're gonna start with the Walmart 2-packs of 2011, and we're doing all of 2011 here in one video. I think I mentioned that in the beginning. So Walmart asked for some 2-packs. I think this might have been a specific ask from the retailer. So the first one we wanted to do was Batman and Robin, which I know makes absolutely no sense. Why you would put Batman and Robin in a pack together is like crazy, but you know, we tried that. Although there was precedent. Mattel has done Batman and Robin in a pack together in the past, so I guess for some reason, you know, everyone from the retailers to the licensors think that this naturally goes together, and they're going to approve this pairing. Okay, you know I'm obviously being sarcastic here, but much like these two packs that went to Toys R Us a few years earlier, Batman and Robin needed a little bit of a refresh. And the idea is that if you could offer them in a different color that's compelling, it's not just repackaging the same thing. Exclusives can be a direct repackage, and that actually does work, and you're going to see some of those in this video. But clever redecos from clever designers like Bill are what really saved the day. So this particular Batman and Robin two-pack, they each got a repaint. So Robin was given kind of classic colors, and Batman was given more kind of 90s gray and black colors using the existing Robin and Batman tools. Now, we had released a Tim Drake Robin in Wave 2 in those colors, in kind of the red and black. So I know this one was a little bit of a hodgepodge because we were kind of using the classic Dick Grayson colors on a Tim Drake body. But, you know, that's kind of what exclusives are all about, is doing sort of little clever things that work from, you know, a certain point of view. It may not be 100% comic accurate, just like that Robin who was wearing blue in that previous pack we looked at. But hey, it worked. And we did get to Dick Grayson in time. And the same thing with Brucey here. We had, you know, the existing Batman tool from Wave 1. Batman, I will say, is a toy maker's gift that never stops giving, because there's so many decos that are fan acceptable for Batman, and even just, you know, kid acceptable. Batman can be in, you know, all sorts of crazy colors. Not just the rainbow Batman, but, you know, you can do, you know, Ice Shield Batman and you know, Yellow Energy Batman and all sorts of stuff, and it just kind of works. Batman is the gift that never stops giving to a toy maker. I will tell you that. All right. So after we were done with our low-hanging fruit of Batman and Robin, we were looking at our tooling bank and thinking, what else can we pair up? And one of the ones that came to mind was Aquaman versus Black Manta. Another one of the classic DC hero versus villain pairings. One thing that works great for kids is underwater characters. So when you've got two underwater characters that, you know, are arch enemies, it's a great theme for kids, because honestly, kids like playing with toys in bathtubs. What can I say? And for collectors, we could find a really clever repaint to both of them, giving Arthur a more regal gold color on his outfit versus the Super Friends orange. And Black Manta had a blue, sort of more lifelike color scheme that Bill had. And I gotta say, Bill also did an amazing thing with Black Manta, and this is really what makes him an outstanding designer. He used a paint that was a rubber paint. So when you touched Black Manta, when you held him in your hand, he actually felt different. He felt rubbery, like a scuba suit. As opposed to, you know, the first Black Manta, which was just done in traditional colors and just had the regular black suit and black plastic with regular paint, it worked. It fit in with the rest of the DCU Classics collection and the whole world. But doing this sort of a rubbery material really made him stand out. And again, created a tactile connection between consumer and product that when you pick it up, you can actually feel, it feels different. It feels kind of, you know, well, rubbery, for lack of a better word. And Aquaman just got a refresh, though. He just went from, as I said, his orange Super Friends colors to a more regal gold. But again, you know, underwater battle, it works. It's just a lineup that is a classic match that works for kids, works for collectors, and hey, another chance to do it. And that's why they were paired up with each other. All right, next up in our 2011 two-packs, we come to Hawkgirl versus Gentleman Ghost. So this one was a complete repack. There were no changes to the figure whatsoever. And of course, a question might be, well, why would you just repack figures that you can already get? And a big reason for that is, for one reason or another, Gentleman Ghost was really hard to find. He was produced in the exact same amount. There are rumors that we produced fewer of him, but it's just not true. I know, because I ran the P&L and had to put in the numbers. I think, honestly, like, you know, other popular DC figures, he just really appealed to kids. Kids saw this character, were like, whoa, it's a ghost! You know, he has no face. I mean, what kid wouldn't want this action figure? You really don't see many action figures of ghosts like this. And of course, he came, you can see at the bottom there, with the head of Giganta and the Atom and her crotch section. But because he was hard to find, it meant that Giganta's head was hard to find. And we reissued his figure in this two-pack so fans could get the figure. But a lot of people were coming with feedback saying, well, okay, this doesn't solve my issue. Yeah, I finally got Gentleman Ghost, but I don't get my Giganta because now the head of the Build-A-Figure, I'm sorry, Collect and Connect, TM and copyright, figure is no longer included as it was when she was released with the Wave, where you built her up with, you know, different parts, arms, legs, torso, head, etc., etc. So a lot of people had a Giganta without a head if they couldn't find Gentleman Ghost. So the reason that we couldn't include the head and, I guess, the crotch section, the part, the build, the Collect and Connect parts that came with Gentleman Ghost, was actually for legal reasons. If you're going to reissue a part of a figure, you have to reissue all of it. So, in other words, we could have just, I mean, like, I love what Marvel Legends is doing by re-releasing Build-A-Figures in single packaging. But there have been some legal rulings and lawyers have spoken, and you can't release just part of a figure without releasing the rest. It's, hey, I don't know, but this is what legal told me at the time. I did fight for it. So that's why Giganta's head is not in the package. All right, blasting through, we're now going to talk about Supes versus a giant purple monster, known to collectors, of course, as Parasite. But to kids, it's Superman versus a giant purple monster, which that's actually the whole point of why we would pair these guys up. Because Superman, much like Batman, is a toy that no child needs explained to them because, you know, Superman, he's been around for 268 years. And giant purple monsters, whether it's known as a specific character to fans or kids just look in the package and they see a giant purple monster with, you know, fangs and white highlights, they just think it's cool. This pack also came from us combing through our library and specifically looking at the early releases that predated DC Universe Classics, which was the DC Superheroes line. And since Parasite was released during the diorama phase on a single card, he hadn't been on shelf in many, many years. So essentially, because we had, you know, he also had a lot of original tooling. So basically, a really cool looking figure that no longer needed to be tooled, the tooling was paid for, so we could stick him in a pack with the new Superman. So like the updated DC Universe Classic Superman, as opposed to the DC Superheroes Superman, which was not as good as the Classics version. And more or less, it was a freebie. And a freebie meaning we didn't have to pay for the tooling, but it was, you know, new to kids. And again, Superman battling giant monsters, you know, Godzilla, King Kong aside, that's just a toyetic theme that works. You could almost pair Superman up with any kind of beast, and it works. And, you know, there's nothing scarier than a giant walking purple gumdrop monster, because, you know, every kid fears that, right? So that was basically why we did this pack. All right, next up, as we round out the two packs, one of my favorites, the Harley Quinn and Joker Mad Love pack. From the, you know, the hearts that were embossed on the bubble to all the accessories to the amazing, amazing job packaging did with the pack out. I mean, words cannot express. And this basically came, again, you know, from finding a pack that would be recognizable and appeal to kids, appeal to collectors, it would work on shelf, and there would be no tooling. So, hey, look, we checked off all the boxes. It's like bingo, really, you know, or when you're doing exclusives. Now, the original version of Harley Quinn, when she was released, which you can actually see here, paired with the repaint of Joker, had blue on her face, like a blue wash. I don't know why. I don't know why at the time we went with blue, design went that way. I think it was a request from DC, but it drove me crazy. Because to me, Harley Quinn has a flat white face. And this blue was just like a needle in my eye that was killing me. And I was trying for years to find a way to re-release Harley so we could do her without the blue wash. Joker, on the other hand, you know, has a lot of different variants, especially when he's just wearing his standard suit. So the original release of Joker was a Walmart exclusive single figure wearing his purple outfit and technically had limited release because it was only at one retailer. And even though this pack would be at one retailer, it was still, you know, getting Joker back out there. And now this time he could be in black. And Harley could have a pure white face without the blue wash. And posing them together like this in package in mid-dance was going to appeal to collectors. They were going to know this because they were going to remember the famous Alex Ross painting that this set was based on. And we could basically make this Alex Ross painting come to life in toy form. So I got my Harley. Fans got their Joker. Well, fans got their Harley too. But I finally had a Harley without the blue wash, which for years I was trying to figure out a way to do that. It's not always easy. And for kids, you know, it's Joker and Harley. And as far as they, you know, it doesn't matter whether it's based on the Alex Ross painting and if they recognize that. They just know these characters from the animated series. And, well, because honestly, Harley is an incredibly popular character when it comes to DC. All right, so wrapping up the two packs, the last one is the Big Red Cheese versus Black Adam. Yeah, I wish we could have called him Big Red Cheese instead of calling him Shazam, because to me, he'll always be Captain Marvel. He'll be, you know, Fawcett's Captain Marvel. Well, I guess DC's Captain. Whatever, it's confusing, but pairing them up is not confusing. Many companies have done that, including DC Direct, because, again, you know, there are archenemies: Joker, Batman, Lex Luthor, Superman, Aquaman, Black Manta, Marvel family, Black Adam. So easy rationale for pairing them up. We don't have to explain. That's the other thing, is when you're selling them into a retail, you have to explain why they're paired up. And so just simply saying, these are archenemies, and for the most part, Shazam, Captain Marvel, is known. This is before the movie, obviously. You know, I mean, I would call him maybe a B-lister, because all obviously super fans know him. The rest of the world knows him, you know, maybe a little bit under Aquaman and Flash, let's say. So they didn't have any changes, though, to their deco. I guess we could have done the yellow wristbands and the yellow highlights on the cape, which I kind of wish we did. But this one was just going to be a straight repaint, a repack, excuse me, with no change to the figure, no change to the deco. The same with Black Adam, although he lost his scarab necklace, which he had in the single release. So I guess you could say maybe you were getting a little less, but you know, you were getting them paired together for a good price, and instant what we call battle in a box. It's a conflict. Great kid play. When you have a good guy versus a bad guy, that's one of the best ways to sell any two-pack. It works way better than even, well, I guess maybe Batman and Robin makes sense, but anytime you can do a you know, a face-off, if you will, conflict, it sells. Okay, last one for 2011 is the Walmart 5-pack. Walmart had seen success with the Gotham City 5-pack in the previous year, so we came back with another one, and for this item we actually had a little tooling. So we had some money to spend to give them the correct parts. So here we go. You got Power Ring and Superwoman, Ultraman, Owlman, and Johnny Quick, as done by the Four Horsemen. Again, look at that face on Ultraman. Which version of Crime Syndicate to do, though? That's kind of one of the things, because there's been a lot of versions of them over the years. And some of them are, you know, the costumes are more complicated, some less complicated. And as far as which version, I don't remember being in on that conversation. I'm sure Bill and the Four Horsemen talked about it, but I'm guessing it came down to the minimum number of new parts. So, you know, which versions of the figures could we do with tooling the least amount? So, you know, Ultraman uses a lot of Superman's parts, obviously. And, how could we also do them so they were toyetic? So we'd already done Lex Luthor when he's a good guy from this universe. Did I mention that the Crime Syndicate is evil versions of the superheroes? I don't know if I mentioned that, but they are. You probably already knew that. So Lex Luthor would be a good guy. So, you know, again, lots of different versions of them over the years. Sometimes they have capes, sometimes they don't have capes. You know, Owlman has these fancy ruffles sometimes. Sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes his cowl sits on his head. So, yeah, I mean, you were never basically going to get it perfect, because we pretty much had one shot at doing them. And, which version you do? There's no way to please everyone when you're tackling something like this, when there's been so many different versions over the years, and the chance of us going back and redoing any of these individual characters a second go-around, slim. But hey, you know, again, face off. Like I said, conflict. So it's like a gang of villains, and you probably already own the heroes. So now you could have awesome battles or shelf displays, however you choose to get it. Kids, collectors, retailers, toy makers, everybody wins. Hopefully people found this one. Whew, that was a lot. Those were a lot of exclusives. Next time we're going to go back to waves, I swear. But hey, we just finished up all of the 2011 exclusives. It was a big year for DCU Classics in 2011. Thank you guys, as always, for tuning in, and we'll continue to do our...
Bye!
Leia, my video. We'll do your videos later. Thanks. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next time on Director's Commentary.
Bye!